The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Oh, Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, please shine down on me. Oh, Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, hiding behind a tree. These little children are asking you to please come out so we can play with you. Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Golden Sun, please shine down on me.
Rose, this is my favorite time of the show. It's our story time you're going to have. Yes. You have a very good book. It's called Firefighters in the Dark. Is that right?
Yes, Mr. Sun, it is.
I can't wait to hear it, Rose.
All right, I'll get to it, Mr. Sun.
Okay.
The fire station is near my house at night. I can hear the sirens howling. I'm in my bed and my eyes are closed. But I listen and I know where they are going. Uh-oh. That don't sound too promising. Do you think, Mr. Sun?
No. I'm afraid. It's in the dark.
Tonight there's a castle on fire. The knights are running around like crazy. And the king and the queen and the 15 little princesses are all screaming. Help, firefighters, help. Uh-oh. I think so. What happened? Was this a fire-breathing dragon stopped in for dinner and his potatoes were too hot? He blew on them to cool them off and set the table on fire? Oh, I don't know. Maybe. What do you think, Mr. Sun?
Well, it sounds pretty hot to me. Let me tell you.
Yeah. Luckily, the firefighters are close by. They chop down the roof of the castle with their axes, and the pumper truck pumps water from the moat. Pretty soon, the fire is out. The 15 baby princesses go back to playing hide-and-seek, and the knights are riding off on their horses to tell the dragon that next time he can have only cold things to eat, like popsicles.
Hmm.
Oh, wow.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Popsicles. That way it saves from having a fire.
Yeah.
It's quiet now. I hear the fire trucks come back to the station. The firefighters are getting out and taking off their boots. I love the firefighters. Their names are King, Penelope, Alumdine, and Bruce. They can carry heavy horses and ladders because they are strong as a tiger's. They have yellow and black boots and black turnout coats and pants with yellow stripes. And they have helmets with visors they put down so smoke doesn't get in their eyes. They're not afraid of anything. What do you think, Mr. Sun?
Firemen are very brave people.
Yeah, very, very brave.
They run right into the fire to save those princesses.
Yeah, I think they're very brave. When they get back to the fire station, they're very dirty from all the ash, and they have to take a bath. But as soon as they're in their tubs playing with the bubbles, the alarm will ring again, and they'll have to slide down the fire pole, still wet from their bath. Uh-oh.
They goes pretty fast down the pole that way.
Yeah, they do. Yeah. I think they like the pole.
Yeah. Slippery pole.
Yeah, I think I like that pole myself,
I think.
Listen, did you hear that? I think I hear the sirens again, howling and howling. The dog down the street is howling too. The sirens sound far away this time. That's because the fire is all the way in Mexico. Uh-oh.
Mexico?
Whew. Wow.
That's quite a ways away from the castle.
Yeah, it is. Wow. What happened was this... There's a garden there full of chili peppers so hot that when you take a bite, your mouth feels like it's on fire. Well, there was a lady in her garden planting poppies, and she felt a little hungry, so she nibbled on a pepper. Mm. It was so hot, sparks flew from her tongue. The firefighters have to come and spray her face with water. Then they take their rakes and their shovels and rake up all the burning embers that fell out of her mouth.
Wow. She must
have
ate a lot of peppers.
What do you think, Mr. Sun?
Yeah.
Wow.
Boy, I'm not going to eat any of them things.
I'm telling you, they're really super hot. That's why I can't eat them. They upset my stomach.
Yes.
Those embers are fire seeds, and they grow into fire flowers. But the firefighters spray them with water until they disappear. The lady's so grateful, she gives them some poppies and zucchinis to take home.
Hmm.
Oh, that's nice of her.
Yeah, I like zucchinis.
Alamdine loves zucchini and Bruce likes bananas. Penelope eats only peas, pasta, and pickles. King likes vegetables, so he's really strong, but toast is his favorite, with lots of jam. They'll be having breakfast soon after they sleep. Maybe I'll go and visit them in the morning. Once they give me a hat and sticky badge, and King let me sit in the truck.
Hmm.
Oh, wow.
He's going to be a fireman one day.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I like sitting in them fire trucks, too.
I do, too.
Another time when I was sleeping, I heard their sirens, but it wasn't a fire. What happened was there was a little boy who was bouncing on his bed, bouncing and bouncing. He bounced so high, he flew through the ceiling and into the sky. He was floating up with the stars saying, "Look at me." And his papa was saying, "Come down here right now. It's time for bed." Oh, boy, he flipped through there.
He was way up there.
Yeah, he was way. So the firefighters came with their aerial ladder truck. The ladder went up and up past the moon and Mars and Venus up to Pluto.
Ooh-wee.
Wow, that's awfully, awfully high.
Yeah.
Where the boy was floating, the boy said, "Did you see how high I jumped?" And Alamdine said, "You can't be up on Pluto in pajamas. You need a space suit and some mittens." And so she carried him down the ladder and back to bed. Wow. That's an awful long ways.
Yes.
That's like millions and millions of miles, I think.
True.
Sometimes at night when I shut my eyes, I can hear the fire engine outside my window. Its motor goes and King stretches the ladder to my bed. "Come out," he says, "and I am right. The fires are too hot tonight. We have to cool them down." So the King brings her out to the fire truck with him, it looks like. So we climb into the truck and drive into the sky. Me, King, Penelope, Almondine, and Bruce. The clouds are full of water, and we put them in our hoses and spray away the fire in the stars.
Hmm.
Oh, wow. What do you think, Mr. Sun?
Ooh, I don't know if you can spray stars away with water. They're pretty hot. I'm a star, and water don't put me out.
Yeah, I don't think so either. Mm-mm. I don't think that would work. I really don't. And that's the end of the book.
Oh, wow. Boy, who wrote that had a really good imagination.
Yes, they do, Mr. Yes. Sun. I do believe so, too.
Yes.
This here is a very, very good book, boys and girls. Mm-hmm. If there's any other books that you would like for me to read, just let Wesley know, and he will get back with me, and I can read it for you. There are many different kinds of books with imagination, with stories that happen for real, and, you know, however else you would like. And there is books with CDs. There is books with, like, free little things in them. Mm-hmm. Or any different things that you touch. Or you can also have books with characters.
Do you have any books that when you open it up, things come out of it? Like...
Yeah, the little pop-up books. Yeah, I know what you're talking about, Mr.
Yeah.
Sun. So just let Wesley know, and he'll get back with me. And you all have a good day. This is Wesley's TVs.
Hi, Rose and Bev.
Hey, Mr. Sun.
How are you today?
Hi.
We're doing good.
Next, we're going to be talking about the history of Squad 51.
LACOFD Squad 7, 1971 Dodge Fargo D-300 Rescue Paramedic Squad with LACOFD shops built utility box. Squad 7 see in the front of their old station in West Hollywood with 51 magnets affixed over the 7 for early stock footage. This is not the same squad used as Squad 10 in the pilot episode. The most obvious indicators are the different license plates, the white bumper. Squad 10 has a red bumper. Also, Squad 7 has notable air bottles and smoke ejector in the back of the squad.
Emergency, Squad 51's 1972 Dodge Fargo D-300 Rescue. It's a paramedic squad with Universal Studios built utility box. Squad 51 was built by the Universal Studios crew to LACOFD specifications and was owned by Universal.
In 1978, after the conclusion of emergency, Squad 51 was donated by Universal to LACOFD and was put into service as a reserve paramedic squad. Notice the blue California license plate, the new mirrors, the new lettering on the door, and the running boards are gone.
In real life, during the emergency years, as more and more rescue squads transitioned into paramedic squads, the real LACOFD rescue squads changed their lettering from rescue squad to paramedic.
Squad 51 never made the changes during its sixth season run and kept the old style rescue squad lettering. In some instances, such as Squad 116 in Carson, just added paramedic to the existing rescue squad lettering. When the old Squad 51 went into reserve status with the LACOFD, these changes were finally made. Also notice that on Squad 51 during the show, Los Angeles County lettering was two rows. Now it has been changed and all on one single row. Did you know that, Mr. Sun and Bev?
No, I didn't know that.
Emergency Squad 51, 1972 Dodge D-300 Rescue Paramedic Squad and Universal Studios built university box. After its years of service as a reserve LACOFD paramedic squad, Squad 51 was donated to LA County Fire Museum in 1998. It was completely rebuilt and faithfully restored to its emergency configuration.
LACOFD Squad 51's 1992 Ford F-350 paramedic squad with SECA utility body LACOFD Universal Studio Squad 60 was renumbered when Station 60 was renumbered to Station 51. In 1996, in honor of the show, with the opening of their brand new station at Universal Studios, by the 1990s, the LACOFD have long since transitioned from two-door squads into four-door crew cab squads. The additional seating to accommodate paramedic trainee squad 60/51 were among the few that were still in two-door squads. Did you know that, Bev and Mr. Sun?
No, I didn't.
Uh-uh.
LACOFD Squad 51's 2005 Ford F-350 paramedic squad with a Phoenix utility box. Now, this new 2005 Ford F-350 replaces their formal 1992 Ford F-350. In 2005, the county continued purchasing Ford F-350s with four-door crew cab for their new paramedic squads. Squad 2 in Palos Verdes 51 at Universal Studios and 88 in Malibu still remained in two-door squads.
LACOFD 2009 Dodge Ram 350 with Phoenix utility box in the publicity event O Squad 51's 1972 Dodge was shown alongside LACOFD's newest Dodge. In 2009, the LACOFD switched from many years of purchasing Ford's F-350s to Dodge Ram 350s. For their new paramedic squads like the Ford squads, all new Dodges have a four-door crew cab. The utility boxes were made by Phoenix. The boxes on later Dodges are made by KME. This 2009 Dodge squad was not ever placed into service as Squad 51, but was dressed up with 51 numbering for the next. At the time of this event, Squad 51 was still in their recently acquired new 2005 Ford two-door squad. Did you know that, Bev?
No. No, it's very interesting what we're learning here.
Did you know that 350 minute was a one-ton truck, 150 is a half-ton, and the three-quarter ton would be a 250.
Oh, wow. No, yeah. That's interesting.
That's very interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, LACOFD Squad 51's 2016 GMC 350 with KME utility box. Now, this new 2016 GMC replaces 51's former 2005 Ford. As the LACOFD was buying all Dodge Rams with four-door crew cabs for their new paramedic squads, they purchased only three GMCs with two-door cabs for Squad 2, 51, and 88. Squad 116's in North Carson needed a smaller squad due to the size of their station. So Station 116 houses an engine, a rear mount, quint, and squad. Squad 51 was traded to Station 116 in a three-way trade that will eventually send 116 squad to 51.
LACOFD 2016 Ford F-350 paramedic squad with Phoenix utility box. This older Ford squad was Station 51's temporary squad for a while till their trade with Squad 116 made its way up to 51's. Did you know that, Beth?
No. This is all new information. LACOFD Squad 51, 2017 Dodge Ram 350 with KME utility box. Now Squad 116, former squad, finally made its way up to 51s in their trade. This Squad 51's current squad. Please stay tuned for more on Wesley TV.
Happy holidays from all of us at Parkview Health.
Nations call and we're listening. In the halls, boys are glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. Walking in a wellness wonderland. Tucked away is the green bird. The tent can still get you transferred. With all the time.
First, we will start with John Gage, which the actor was Randolph Mantooth.
Randolph Mantooth is an American actor who has worked in television, documentary, theater, and film for more than 40 years. He was a graduate of American Academy of Dramatic Arts, and he was discovered in New York City by Universal Studios talent agent while performing the lead in the play, Philadelphia, Here I Come. He was born in September 19, 1945, in Sacramento, California.
Next is Roy DeSalto, which is the actor Kevin Tye.
Kevin Tye is an American actor who has worked in television, film, and theater since the late 1960s. He is best known for his character firefighter paramedic Roy DeSoto on the 1972 to 1977 NBC series Emergency. Tye was cast in his first major film as an extra in 1967, The Graduate. He was born August 13th, 1944 in Los Angeles, California. Did you know that, Mr. Sun?
No, I didn't know that. And next is Nurse Dixie McCall, which the actress was Julie London.
Well, Julie London was an American singer and actress whose career spanned more than 40 years. A touch singer noted for her sultry, languid contralto vocals, London recorded over 30 albums of pop and jazz standards between 1955 and 1969. She was born September 26, 1926, in Santa Rosa, California, and died October 18, 2000, in Encino Darsana Regional Medical Center in Encino, California. Her spouse was Bobby Troop, which was played in Emergency as Dr. Joe Early. Boy, that's very interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, very interesting.
Yes, it is. I didn't know that. Now, next we're going to talk about Dr. Kelly Brackett, which the actor was Robert Fuller.
Robert Fuller is an American horse rancher and retired actor. He began his career on television guest starring primarily on Western programs while appearing in several movies, including The Brain from Planet Aurora's Teenage Thunder, Return of the Seven, Incident at Phantom Hill, and The Hard Rider. He was born July 29, 1933 in Troy, New York. Did you know that, Mr. Sun?
No, I didn't know that. Now, next we're going to talk about Dr. Joe Early, which the actor was Robert, they call him Bobby, Robert Trump Jr., Troop Jr.
Well, Robert William Troop Jr. was an American actor, a jazz pianist, singer, and songwriter. He wrote the song Route 66 and acted in the role of Dr. Joe Early with his wife, Julie London, in the television program Emergency. In the 1970s, he was born on October 18, 1918, in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and he died February 7, 1999, in Sherman Oaks, Los Angeles, California.
Wow. And next, we're going to talk about a fireman, which is called Chet Kelly, which the actor was Tom Donnelly, that just died in the year 2021.
Timothy David Donnelly was an American film and television actor. He was perhaps best known for playing the role of as fireman Chet Kelly in NBC's Emergency. He was born on September 3, 1944 in Los Angeles, California, and died September 17, 2021 in Santa Fe, New Mexico. Did you know that?
No, I did not know that. Next, we're going to talk about another fireman named Mike Stoker, which was played by Mike Stoker himself.
Well, did you know that firefighter Mike Stoker of Emergency was an active real-life LACOFD firefighter? And when Emergency was in production, Mike Stoker was an engineer at LACOFD 69, where he drove engine 69 and he operated the engine's water pumps exactly the same as what he did on the Emergency.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah,
wow.
That is.
He played himself. Wow. Yeah. Next, we're going to talk about Captain Henry Hank Stanley. Henry, and they sometimes call him Hank. As an actor, he was Michael Norwell. Norwell, yeah.
Michael Alden Norwell is an American screenwriter, actor, and executive producer who starred as Captain Henry Hank Stanley in Jack Webb production television series Emergency from 1972 to 1978. He was born October 4th, 1937 in Idaho.
Next, we are talking about Dr. Mike Morton. As an actor, he actually was Ron Pinkard.
Well, Ron F. Pinkard is an American actor best known for his role as Dr. Mike Morton in the Jack Webb-produced television series Emergency. He is known to be the TKO on everything.
Next, we are talking about Marco Lopez, which was playing as himself, Marco Lopez.
Marco Antonio Lopez is an American actor who played several parts in the supporting cast of Jack Webb's Mark 7, limited television series Dragnet, and Adam 12. He also served as Webb's stand-in for Long Shots. His first Hollywood job was a stand-in for Elvis Presley in the 1956 movie Love Me Tender. In 1971, Webb offered Lopez the role that would bring him into the homes of millions of Americans, weekly that of firefighter Marco Lopez in the television program series Emergency. Co-star Los Angeles County Fire Department engineer and actor Mike Stoker, Lopez used his real name as his character name, which led to confusion that he was an actual firefighter with the LACOFD. He had never worked with the LACOFD at any time. Please stay tuned for more on Wesley's TV.
If you ever plan to motor west, travel my way, take the highway, that's the best. Get your kids on Route 66. It winds from Chicago to L.A. More than 2,000 miles all the way. Get your kicks on Route 66.
Hey, you go through St. Louis, Joplin, Missouri, Oklahoma City looks mighty pretty. You'll see Amarillo, Gallup, New Mexico, Flagstaff, Arizona, don't forget Pomona, Kingman, Barstow, San Bernardino.
Won't you get hip to this timely tip when you make the California trip? Get your kicks on Route 66. If you ever plan to motor west, travel my way, take the highway, that's the best. Get your kicks on Route 66.
It winds from Chicago to L.A.
More than 2,000 miles all the way. Get your kicks on Route 66.
Now you go through St. Louis, Joplin, Missouri, Oklahoma City looks mighty pretty.
You see Amarillo, Gallup, New Mexico,
Flagstaff, Arizona,
don't forget Winona,
Kingman,
Boston,
San Bernardino. Won't you get hit to this timely tip when you make that California trip? Get your kicks on Route 66.
Christmas tree, how lovely are your branches.
we have a friend of ours, a crew member. His name is Juan Gonzalez Abundas, a bus driver here in Fort Wayne, Indiana, which was part of Fort Wayne City Link.
Yeah, Juan Carlos Gonzalez Abundas, Carlos Gonzalez Abundas, 49, passed away on Tuesday, February 8th, 2022, at Luther Hospital, was born in Mexico. Juan was a son of the late Abraham Gonzalez and Alita Abundas.
Juan has worked for Centerwing as a Centerwing bus driver for almost 17 years. I know him for a really long time myself. He is a really dedicated money employee, and he was willing to help in need. He enjoyed fishing, running for the coats, and spending time with his friends and families at tow-outs. And as for something to say about the toads, you can tell when he's coming, because he will have, during the football season, he will have a sign saying "Don't Toads" on his bus.
Yeah,
side.
I believe it, yeah. He was a rooter for the Colts, yeah.
Yes.
I believe it. Surviving are his wife of 18 years, Daniela, daughter Trinity, siblings Thomas, Juanita, Christina, Garciela, Susan, Marciela, along with his beloved fur babies, Sarge, Pepe, and Bella.
Please stay tuned for more on Wesley TV.
Oh,
As we continue to navigate the COVID-19 pandemic, safety is a top priority for our patients, visitors, and staff. We are doing everything we can to ensure that our facilities and the dedicated men and women who deliver the care within the walls continue to function at an optimal level while minimizing the risk of transmitting the virus. To demonstrate the safety measures in place across the Parkview Health System, we've invited team members from each of our community hospitals to share a behind-the-scenes glimpse at just some of the preventative practices in place.
I watched a video that Dr. Myers sent us of an anesthesiologist with the hand washing.
Mm-hmm.
And after he kind of washed his hands, he does webs, tips, knuckles, wrists. It is the number one way to decrease the spread of germs to our patients, to each other, and to ourselves, and taking it home to our family. Before we enter into a room, we either sanitize our hands with alcohol, or we wash our hands upon entering the room, and then upon leaving, if we've been doing a procedure where they're visibly soiled, we wash our hands with soap or water, or we take our gloves off, and then we sanitize with alcohol on the way out. At the nurse's station, outside of every room, they're readily available, so you can just reach to the side and grab a squirt. In the break room, by the bathrooms, there's hand sanitizing stations readily available.
PPE is personal protective equipment. The personal protective equipment also helps protect me as well as the patient from the spread of germs and viruses. Gowns help protect us from any blood exposure, anyone who's coughing or sneezing, any body fluids. We have gloves, so any touch contact, that helps with reducing any contamination that way. The masks help prevent us from inhaling any particles. Also, if we exhale any particles, it helps protect the patient. And then my goggles protect my eyes and mucous membranes.
So if we have a patient come into the ER in respiratory distress, we'll take them immediately back to a negative airflow room. We have this special part that we can use if we need to do any type of intubation. That is a high-risk procedure, so for that we will only have the primary RN, the doctor, and the respiratory therapist in the room. That's going to decrease exposure for the rest of the staff. We'll also have another staff member outside the room to grab other supplies that we might need.
So some of the changes that we've been able to make is we've been able to create more negative airflow pressure rooms. We originally only had 2, and now we have 10, which is awesome. So I know that word kind of sounds scary. What is negative airflow? Negative airflow just means that we are not going to be recycling the air throughout the hospital, and that this room will have its own fresh air every minute. And that way we can protect you guys and ourselves from everyone else as we're walking in and out of here.
At Parkview Noble Emergency Room, we continue being safe so we can provide our patients with safe, excellent care. We do that by wearing a PAPR when we are taking care of patients who have COVID symptoms. And when we don't wear PAPRs, we're wearing our N95s and our goggles to keep everyone safe.
We are asking everyone to wear a mask while they are here at the hospital. This includes patients, visitors, nurses, doctors, and the rest of the staff. When we all wear masks, it will help protect each other from the risk of being exposed to COVID-19.
As an EBS team member, I can tell you cleaning and disinfecting is the first line of defense in protecting patients and coworkers. Parkview has an enhanced cleaning measures for the safety of everyone who is treated in or works in the emergency department here at Parkview Huntington. Getting patients better safely is our priority.
At our emergency department, we have instituted safety precautions for your visit, including social distancing, helpful signage, and restricted visitation. Please do not delay your care. We have dedicated and skilled coworkers and physicians here ready to assist you in your time in need.
Happy holidays from all of us at Parkview Health.
On the first day of Christmas, my Parkview gave to me a hospital in my community. On the second day of Christmas, my Parkview gave to me two acts of love and a hospital in my community. On the third day of Christmas, my Parkview gave to me three true friends, two acts of love and a hospital in my community. On the fourth day of Christmas, my Parkview gave to me four healing cures, three true friends.
7 trainers,